focused on elite athleticism, on power, character, and grace. Today, rugby makes its play for excellence. Where would Brook finish in the hammer throw?
Look at this, a huge reverse pass from Brook to his brother Robin. It goes out to Tomei, and Tomei scores! Oh, how do you stop Zimzan Brook?
Or Eels in the high jump. And Sean Fitzpatrick, he could captain any team, anywhere. Australia versus New Zealand. No medals, just plenty of pride. It's true, the All Blacks have retained the Bledisloe Cup. But this is not just about a trophy. It's deeper, more personal. Since they last met, both have beaten the world champions. To the Wallabies, though, only triumph today can erase the wounds of Windy Wellington. They've come here to Suncorp Stadium, Brisbane, the old Lang Park Cauldron. By tradition, home of parochialism and passion. By nature, an inspiring place to be on a day like today.
Yes, almost inner city, Suncorp Stadium, the home of Queensland Rugby League, opens its doors to rugby union for only the third time in history, the last 30 years ago. And this afternoon, the biggest crowd of all football codes in Brisbane this season, it's a sellout, 42,000 fans for this fourth match of the inaugural Tri-Nation Series. Well, joining me in commentary is former Wallaby captain Simon Poitevin, a proud new father for the first time this week, but this is the rematch from that debacle at Wellington, do or die for the Wallabies.
Yes, Wellington was a shock of the Australians, but today they take heart from Kieran Perkins' great win of the 1500 metres. They, like him, have been written off by most out there. How they do it, carry on the defence from Sydney against the Springboks, it was outstanding. But Pat Howard must spin that ball wide to our three outside backs, Campese, Burke and Tune.
OK, let's have a look at the table then. And we see that New Zealand is unbeaten. If they win today, they wrap up the Tri-Nation Series. Australia has to win to keep their hopes alive, and South Africa desperate for a Wallaby victory. But the two sides arrived, and the Australians, I think, Simon, must have been inspired by the performances over at Atlanta in the swimming pool. Susie O'Neill and Kieran Perkins.
Well, they're all watching the swimming this morning, and they know this is the last chance for them to get the pride going to stay in this Tri-Nation Series. Tim Horan, a broken nose, he's out.
Sean Fitzpatrick is 79th international. What a great man he is, closing on the all-time record of Willie John McBride. And also remember too that the New Zealanders in Atlanta had a 1-2 in the individual three-day equestrian event. Well, there was a lot of controversy at Athletic Park in Wellington as the Wallabies ignored the New Zealand haka. Here's what Coach John Hart had to say about that.
The haka is not part of psychology of the game. The haka is part of New Zealand, part of culture in New Zealand. It's not the psychology of the game.
So it's about respect?
It's about respect, yeah. That's all it is. It is about respecting a New Zealand tradition.
So, Simon, what is going to happen today? Are the Wallabies going to stand their ground?
Well, I think the haka's a great experience. They should get out there and enjoy it.
OK. After the break, then, Chris Handy returns head-to-head with the Wallabies and the All Blacks. And we also take you on an exclusive walk through the Wallaby dressing room. Back shortly. To rugby league fans here in Queensland, it's the cauldron, the cooking pot for New South Wales cockroaches. But today, it's uncharted territory for both Australia and New Zealand. Well, also joining us in commentary is Chris Handy, who knows all about pride, power and passion in these Bledisloe Cup games. But Chris, you've been there in these games. What about New Zealand, their first test match away from home? What can we expect today?
Good, and I think we can expect that same professional performance that we saw in Wellington a few weeks ago. John Hart is a professional. He's prepared them for the big journey ahead to South Africa, and I don't think they're going to let the Wallabies stand in their way. But for Australia, the Wallabies, they'll need a Harry Houdini trick, just like Kieran Perkins, who hauled himself back from being discounted to win gold for Australia. That'll be a great motivation. There's a couple of weaknesses in the team, a couple of changes to the team. Timmy Horan's slots will be hard to replace. But I think what will happen, and you can tell as we come head-to-head, that on paper the New Zealand look a 10 point better team, but I've seen that before, and I've seen Wallaby sides claw their way back. Hopefully it's a great one. Look at it head to head.
Australia and New Zealand meet for the 102nd time at Test level. The opposing fullbacks are both in exceptional form. It's Matthew Burke versus Christian Cullen. On the wing, teenager Ben Tune again has the responsibility of containing Jonah Lomu. At outside centre, impressive Joe Rock renews his vigorous confrontation with rugged Frank Bunce. Their respective centre partners are Waratah Richard Toms and hard-running Walter Little. Completing the three-quarter lines, David Campese faces the elusive Otago flyer Jeff Wilson. Opposing fly halves are young Queenslander Pat Howard and prolific point scorer Andrew Mertens. At scrum half, a spirited duel expected between ACT's George Gregan and Canterbury's Justin Marshall. The two number eights are in form, Michael Bryle and versatile Auckland captain Zinzan Brook. Two skillful dashes on the open side flank, it's David Wilson and Josh Cronfell. At blindside, Daniel Manu, fresh from his stormer against the Springboks, opposing the champ, Michael Jones. In the second row, outstanding locks John Eales and Ian Jones renew their great rivalry. So do Garrick Morgan from Souths here in Brisbane and gritty Aucklander Robin Brook. At tight head prop, the Ox Andrew Heat gets a crack at the impressive Craig Dowd. The two hookers are 73 tests apart. Michael Foley plays his sixth and Sean Fitzpatrick his 79th. The remaining front row clash brings together powerful Richard Harry and the wily scrum surgeon, Olo Brown. Yes, 9 of the 15 Australian players have 10 test matches or less, so there's a lot of inexperience there. But let's now check on the Australian dressing room for last-minute preparations. And Chris Handy, there Andrew Heath. He's got a big job this afternoon.
Both props, Richard Harry and Andrew Heath, got big jobs. Andrew Heath said last week he was up to the task. Now they've got to prove it again today.
And Simon, John Eales, a great win over South Africa. He's got to lead by example again.
Yeah, John Eales had a fairly quiet series so far, but I'll tell you what, expect him to explode today.
The Australians have had a very angry preparation. There's been a lot of aggression at training, a few punch-ups we hear, so too New Zealand.
Well, it's good to see out there. There's a lot of tension on both sides coming to this game, especially the Australian side. And great to have Tim Gavin there to provide some strong moral support now too.
There's Michael Bryle. Chris Handy, how does this atmosphere look to you?
Oh, it's fantastic. Good, and back at Suncorp, these boys are prepared. They know how hard the task is. They'll just have to get out and do it.
And there's Garrick Morgan. This was his home ground last year with the South Queensland Crushers. So we're just over 15 minutes away now from the kickoff. We'll take a break, but we'll be back to profile the comeback kid, the man who overcame adversity to reach triumph, Michael Bryle, back shortly. New Zealand has already won the Bledisloe Cup by virtue of their victory at Athletic Park, but this is the 102nd test between the Wallabies and the All Blacks. They first met in 1903 at the Sydney Cricket Ground. But the All Blacks looking for their 70th win over Australia today, Simon Poitevin, and they are long odds on with the bookmakers.
Well, they deserve to be. They're really class outfit, and a lot of skill and experience there. We have the Australian dressing room here, big dressing room, plenty of room to warm up there. They don't have to go to Wellington there and be out in the weather. Jake Howard there, the forward master there, keeping an eye on things. Big game here today for Andrew Heath. We expect a verbal assault from Sean Fitzpatrick. He's great at doing that sort of thing.
Yes, well, the Australians know that this is their moment of truth. It's a must-win situation today. And the All Blacks also going through their last-minute warm-ups. There is John Hart, this All Black coach, the man who built the Auckland team in the 80s to the best provincial team in the world.
Yeah, he's all professional, John Hart, and he's got this side so well organised. The All Blacks, they've got a big tour ahead in South Africa. Can they have the same hunger here today, trying to finish off this Australian leg of that tour?
Walter Little, one of the outstanding players in the New Zealand midfield. Well, after spending 3 years in the wilderness, Australia's number eight, Michael Bryle, has conquered adversity to return to the Wallaby ranks, and he's produced two man of the match performances, and his inspiration has been a novel training regime. Sydney Harbour and a surf ski have been the catalyst for Michael Bryle's return from the rugby wilderness. Discarded for last year's World Cup, he became disillusioned and was ready to throw his boots away for good. Enter a new Wallaby coach, and some persuasion from close friends like Tim Gavin, and the transformation of Australia's new number eight was in place.
Most of it doesn't seem like really hard training, you know. It was just a lot of fun, if anything, and it was very easy to get motivated.
Brayle's major failing in the past has been his on-field work rate. Tackling that issue head-on, he set out to attain new levels of power and fitness. His first run-on test at home against Wales was a fitting reward for honesty and sheer hard work.
To be picked, you know, first up in Sydney was just amazing, you know. To play at the Sydney Football Stadium in front of a lot of friends was just, you know, that was like, it's, I guess it just counted my first one, really.
But Brayle's honeymoon came to a shuddering halt 3 weeks ago in New Zealand. The heaviest Wallaby defeat in Test history.
Brayle's gone a fraction too far. All the others have been committed.
We seemed to be very slow. Slow to the ball, reaction was slow, and you know, we just weren't ready for it, really. They gave us a good hiding.
Now comes the rematch, and apparently the All Blacks can expect some of the same medicine they dished out in that Wellington mud.
Every time I was in a ruck at a mall, I got, you know, belled a cheap shot. It was a very hard physical game, and I think Australians as a whole don't do that, and I think we've got to get that into our game.
A bit of mongrel.
Yeah, well, yeah. The word I'm looking for I can't use on television.
Yes, Michael Brayle, and there's a terrific atmosphere here at Suncorp Stadium. We're being entertained by the massed choirs at the moment, but the toss is taking place. We're under 10 minutes away from the start now. John Eales and Sean Fitzpatrick. John Eales won the toss at Athletic Park and ran with the breeze. He might regret that one in hindsight. Sean Fitzpatrick wins the toss. And I just wonder if he's going to kick off. We'll soon find out. But there certainly is a wonderful scene here. And waltzing Matilda from the crowd, they're also singing World in Union. So the ground in very good condition. And after the break, the two sides will take the field for this historic test match here at Suncorp. But the crowd really enjoying the occasion. We've just seen Kieran Perkins, 1,500 metres, replayed on the giant screen. Will we see the Australians face the Haka? We'll know in a few minutes. Back shortly. Pettislow Cup, first donated by the Governor-General of New Zealand back in 1931. It was won at Auckland by the All Blacks. And the rain has held off. We've had a deluge overnight, but this is a very good draining ground. And we are awaiting now the arrival of the two sides. But it really is a fabulous scene here, Simon Porterman.
Well, the crowd are really pumped. A lot of Australian support up here, and we're seeing New Zealanders all painted around the ground as well. So a terrific atmosphere, and both sides a firm surface, so expect a very exciting running game.
Chris Handy, you're down on the touchline, and this ground has really held up superbly.
They're going off down here, Gordon, buoyed by all the schoolboy crowds around, and Nudgee and Churchy played so well. As Terrace against Churchy, Terrace against Ipswich Grammar, I'm sure will today for the Premiership. This crowd is just flush. They're full on. It's one of the few afternoon test matches we'll ever see in Brisbane, and it's great.
Well, you saw a banner there, Jay and Jay, Jeff and Josh. We also had Jonah Lomu and Josh Cronfeld rooming during the World Cup. And Chris Handy has his fan club here too.
I just think that's a beautiful image of me. Probably very appropriate, good.
And we welcome viewers around the world, the Australian retired captain Alan Border, a fascinated spectator here this afternoon for this fourth match of the Tri-Nation Series in 1996. It's sudden death for the Wallabies, who take on the New Zealand All Blacks. They are unbeaten with victories over Australia and South Africa. The South Africans hoping for a Wallaby victory this afternoon to stay alive. With me in commentary, two former Wallaby greats, Simon Poitevin and Chris Handy. Simon, what an amazing build-up to this game. A lot of angst in the training sessions, punch-ups in both.
Yeah, plenty of that. And the big news is that Joe played today. During the week, he's dealing with his heart to force to bring. Here he comes.
Well, he's there to stay off each other. Wonderful.
On Fitzpatrick, back outfits. Lomu's face in up the training. They are Joe. 17th international. So New Zealand out on the park. The All Blacks have fielded throughout the Tri-Nations. Their up boasts 450 caps to 163 in the backs. Lomu has overcome that knee strain. The senior man is Walter Little in his 40th test. Up front, Michael Jones, his 11th season of test rugby. And there, Michael Jones. He played in the inaugural World Cup and in 1991, but because of his religious beliefs, didn't make it in 1995.
Well, he's a nightmare for the Australian inside backs down at Wellington. They've got to really keep an eye on Jones today. He's a devastating attacker and defender.
The great John Eales, acknowledged as number one in the world in his position. He's gone through his ritual with his 93-year-old grandmother, Nonna, with her statue of St. Anthony at home on Thursday night. It happens before every test match. And now the Australians out onto Suncorp Stadium for the first time in 30 years. Incredibly, there are just four survivors from the side that took the field in Sydney for the century of test matches between Australia and New Zealand last season. And there is Richard Toms. He lost his brother in that tragic Black Hawk helicopter accident a month ago. But looking at the Australian side, Matt Burke and Joe Roth in the backs, Daniel Manu and John Eales in the pack. They're the four survivors from that centenary test match last year. 10 players survived the record loss against New Zealand 3 weeks ago in Wellington. Take out David Campese and there are just 53 test caps in the backs. The front row, 11 caps between them. So we're standing by now for the national anthems and both teams in a huddle. From the mass choirs at the Sydney Football Stadium, we saw great crowd participation with the Australian anthem. I think the fans have been eagerly waiting for the New Zealand haka. The players from Australia are still standing in a huddle and they're separated by the massed choir. So what's going to happen here, Simon Poitevin? What should happen?
Well, I think the Australians should stand up for the haka. It's a great experience. Eye-to-eye contact with the opposition. The old days against Wayne Shelford there was amazing stuff. And Zinzan Brook here leading the charge. Looks as though the Australians are going to stay in a huddle, away from it.
As we remember in the really old days, Simon, the All Blacks used to do it on both sides of the field as a demonstration. It's a great part of New Zealand tradition. It's a wonderful performance, and the crowd here responding to it superbly. They love it. The Wallabies have got a lot to do today. They're trying to concentrate and get on with it. Fantastic feeling.
Here we go. Zinzan Brook leads the way. The Australians ignoring them. The psychological advantage out of all of that. Sean Fitzpatrick won the toss. He's decided to run into the breeze in the first half. It's not a big breeze, Chris, but certainly there is one there.
Gordon, there's very little here at ground level, but there's little advantage now. The flag just lying on top of the flagpoles just asleep, but they're not asleep here on the field, I can tell you. They're very much awake, and we're going to see something special.
And note number 16, Glenn Osborne, into the New Zealand reserve bench.
Well, Osborne on the reserves, and Eric Rush up in the commentary box.
Yes, and there's our referee, Jim Fleming, the 40-year-old chartered surveyor from Edinburgh, his 25th major international, one of the leading international whistlers in the game. And he had that memorable World Cup semi-final between Australia and New Zealand. Simon Poitevin played that day back in 1991 at Lansdowne Road.
He was very good in that semi-final. The week before in the quarter-final against Ireland, I thought he was very ordinary, but he's a very, very experienced referee. He's a cool customer. Can be a bit arrogant out there. Let's hope he doesn't take that arrogance too far today.
He's assisted by Ray Megson, who had charge of New Zealand and South Africa last weekend, and Ken McCartney. Here we go. John Eales herring after this kickoff. A good start for Australia. Eales getting the rebounds. Andrew Heath leads the way. And what a contrast to Athletic Park Wellington 3 weeks ago when New Zealand stole the ball.
Well, that's the start the Wallabies wanted. Andrew Heath really should have gone to ground much quicker then. Kept the ball alive. New Zealand now at the throw-in. And Ian Jones will invariably win the ball.
Great part of the Australian play has been the way they've been attacking these kickoffs. There's previously been a problem, but that looks like a good start.
Lost by New Zealand at the front. It seemed to stick to Fitzpatrick's hands. It's only 15 metres out. Here's Howard. Toms has cut out. Tune couldn't hold on. That was an opportunity. The pass was high, but he should have taken it, as Australia tried to stretch New Zealand early on. Now New Zealand counter. Let you get the feeling they've been let off the hook there.
That's one of the problems of a late change with personnel on the back line. Richard Toms, he's had a terrific Super 12 series, but he's just coming on Thursday with Tim Horan breaking his nose, running into George Gregan, and that pass was certainly a result of that late inclusion.
Walter Little and Frank Bunt superb against South Africa for the All Blacks. Rock solid in the middle. Australian trying to work it really wide.
John Eales. Richard Harry came in. George Gregan now talking to his forward pack. It's 10 metres from halfway. Good drive here by the Wallaby forwards. They're trying to keep it up off the ground.
Use it!
They have to get it back here. Well, they had it up off the ground. The referee claimed it was stationary there. I think he may have been a little premature, but the Wallabies have to be very alert out there.
Well, that's a mind-boggling decision from the referee. The Australians were clearly using that ball.
Crowd told him exactly what they thought of him from down here.
Easy. Hey.
The back row has to stay bound until the ball is out of the scrum. So a couple of things going against the Australians early on. Scrum engagement, all important here.
And the pack weight's a 70-kilo advantage to the Australian side. But don't expect to see the same advantage in the scrummaging. They've got a lot of experience in that front row.
They intimidated the Wallabies in the front row in Wellington. They verbaled them, they out-scrummed them. They don't want the same thing to happen today, the Wallabies, but good advantage there from the All Blacks.
New Zealand got a very good hit on the Wallaby front row that time. And this looks like a penalty against Michael Foley. rubbing his hand in the opponent's face.
The All Blacks are expert at this. They will pull somebody on personally in the front row, and it's Foley because they see him to be the tough man, the experienced man in the scrum, and they've got in his face.
Number two.
They've taken his face. He's reacted. He was wrong to react that way because Jim Fleming was right onto it. Personally, it's a good reaction, but for the team, maybe not such a great result.
Well, you're right, Buddha. They'll move that round. Sean Fitzpatrick, a master at stirring up the opposing front three. They'll start with Foley, then move to Heath, then move to Harry.
And he's expert. He is the best in the world, Sean Fitzpatrick, and there's no doubt about it, and has been so for quite some time.
Inside the opening 4 minutes, Andrew Mertens from 37 metres out, 20 off centre. It's a nice strike of the ball. Touch judges are happy. New Zealand, mistake-free after losing the ball at the kickoff, have clawed their way back.
The Australians going for the split kickoff here again. John Eales on one side, Garrick Morgan the other. Daniel Manu on this side with Morgan. So it gives Matthew Burke the options there.
Matthew Burke playing his 17th international this afternoon. And he goes left to Eales, who again leads the charge. Taken by Brook.
Robbie!
This is Marshall. Cronfeld there. Wallabies clean him out. New Zealand lacking numbers that time. 22 metre line.
See back.
Marshall back to Burke. 12 from halfway. Long kick down to Mertens, 10 out from his goal line. And he goes up the touchline and takes play to within 13 metres of the halfway line. New Zealand 3, Australia 0.
There's a centre, please. Move down. Down.
John Eales taking that spot at number 5 in the 5-man line-out. It's had some success against South Africa with this line-out. They may try it again today.
New Zealand spoiled the Australian ball that time. Morgan was just out-jumped. New Zealand's first line-out win. What a great tackle. Ben Tune on Lomu. Penalty has been awarded. An early fracas, but things settle down pretty quickly. And right. Touch judge, Mr. McCartney, is in.
Great decision from the referee, Jim Fleming. That time it was that penalty. Lomu tackled. The tackle completed and he wouldn't release the ball. But it went on with Michael Bryle and also Frank Bunce, two great competitors. Let's have a look at it. Great tackle from Chern. Brings Lomu down. Then it's completed without releasing it. And the fight comes on just a little bit later. Bryle comes through and makes the tackle on Bunce, who disagrees with it. He's got the ball. And Bryle, I think, will be penalised out of it. You can't go on with it. Bryle got a lot of emotion there. Just bad play. We had the penalty and now we will lose it in a new decision. And he'll be very lucky to stay on the field.
Really great lead-up work from the Australians then. A superb tackle by Tune and Michael Bryle. Come on, wake up. We can't give these sort of penalties away.
Well, there's a big gap in experience in these two sides. And Australia's lack of it showing through in the early stages.
But also, Gordon, we see a bit of aggression, which they didn't have at Athletic Park Wellington. And if they can control these early nerves and this early emotion, then they'll do a lot better.
Ian Jones superbly back through Brook's hands. Mertens back to Lomu. Manu tried to steal it. We're on the halfway line. Cronfeld, Foley the tackler, with Howard. Held up off the ground that time. Australia sensing they have a chance to get it. But another penalty against the Wallabies on halfway.
Well, Jim Fleming gave Andrew Heath plenty of warning there. He came round offside, he's been penalised.
Number three,
Andrew Heath. Just going back to that Bryle and Bunce incident, let's go back to New South Wales versus the All Blacks, I think 1992. When Frank Bunce really cleaned up Michael Bryle in a very, very nasty incident. I think it goes back a bit till then. Here we are, a breakdown. Andrew Heath is the man, number 3, who's the referee is talking to in this situation. You see him skip round the back now as the replay finishes.
So New Zealand with a three-man line-out, taken by Dowd at the front, wrapped up by Heath, controlled by the All Blacks again. Brook, chip and chase. Burke's there, so is Gregan, he gets the mark.
Lucky not to get the penalty, he was impeded after he chipped the ball ahead. One of the Wallabies turning in his way, but Tim Fleming doing a good game at the moment, really right on top of the players.
Burke doesn't gain a lot of ground. We're 30 metres out from the Australian goal line.
Foley just stopping and standing in his way. He needs to be careful. The referee has his eye on him. And in the end, it worked out successfully.
New Zealand has won three straight lineouts.
That's okay. Here we go.
Jones jumping in the middle again. Superb control. Ollie Brown lost it. Crunching defence from Braille.
It was the assist from Pat Howard to Gordon that bumped that ball free, and this is the competition we expect to see. It's a great throw to the back. They've got Dowd around, it's Ollie Brown at the back. There Braille, and then the bump from Howard. Combination ball free.
Taken by Braille at the back. 35 metres out. Now it's Howard. Big spiral torpedo kick down to Cullen. The youngster from Wellington, just 20 years of age, to Lomu. Howard in for the tackle, he didn't put him to ground. Morgan, Eels gets him over the top. But a great charge from Big Jonah. Loose pass back to Mertens, he cleans up well.
Well, Andrew Mertens is one player that the Australian back row and George Gregan from halfback, Paddy Howard from fly half, have to really pressure this game. He had a very ordinary game against the Springboks last weekend. First time I've seen him play a substandard game.
Now Michael Foley must get the ball on the spot. And if he's throwing to Garrick Morgan, as we saw in the first throw to him, he's not taking the space. He's not coming across the line. He went up and down on the one spot. He's got to come across and get the ball.
Garrick Morgan. It's a fine throw from Foley. Australia have edged it ahead by 8 metres. That's Braille.
He's going off. He is full of fire, Michael Braille.
Now Campisi in a fly half. It's a tester here for Cullen. Outside he's 22. He took it well. Kick was just a little too far. New Zealand, 10 from halfway. Marshall now to Mertens. Getting it into space here. Little, he lost ahead. Here's Campisi. Nicely to Tune. Ben Tune, 22. Gregan's with him. Marshall there first.
Oh, Ben Tune. George Gregan on the outside. They could have used the combination there. Pretty rocky start here by the All Blacks.
Good pressure from both teams, and they're straight back into it. There is non-stop action.
Here's Joe Roff. Angling it. And Zinzan Brook just manages to tiptoe inside the touchline. Gets his touch on halfway.
We saw it, Wellington, as we see all around the world. Bring back Buck. Well, Buck Shelford was great. But this man, Zinzan Brook, has proven to be the classiest number eight in the world. And Tune comes downfield. He was covered out wide. But Justin Marshall entering this team, he's just done everything.
Foley again. Zinzan Brook with one of those backflip passes. Mertens charging onto it. That's Jones. Tackled by Manu, they lost it. Here's Australia. Joe Roff. Tune now. Lobby to Beats. Gregan. Cut it across. Gregan. He got it.
Well, George Gregan. Jeff Wilson wasn't there to knock the ball out of his hands. And Gregan, what a superb try. The counter-attack from the Australians from the mistake for the All Blacks. Joey Roff plays his hand beautifully. Gets all out the Tune. Tune has been on fire in this game so far. And Gregan, he's got a lot of pace. Look at him go, the style. And Christian Cullen not across there to put him down.
And beautiful work by George Gregan. You can see him going, yes, yes, just like they were at Bullseye. Atlanta for Kieran Perkins. The beautiful work here. They counter-attack the All Blacks. Jones gets it bumped from him. There's the tackle from Manu. Bryles on the spot and scoops it free. Working it wide beautifully. Roth drew Cullen. Look at him stand Cullen up. Great play. Shearn comes inside Lomu. He finds it hard to turn. Cullen comes again. And Gregan, he's got it on his face. Yes, go you good thing, George Gregan.
George Gregan gets his second test try in his 14th international. He was dropped after the first test against Wales at Ballymore. A triumphant return. Burke has steered that one out to the left. So Australia enjoying a two-point lead, scoring the only try of the game. And it came after 12 minutes.
Well, what a change to the game from last weekend. The Springboks versus the All Blacks, a very dour affair. This one, plenty of ball movement and the great counter-attack from both sides. Really feeding off the other's mistakes.
Yes, New Zealand have turned the ball over four or five times. Very uncharacteristic. This is Little. Slipped it back nicely there to Dowd. He's Cronfeld and Mertens. Coming down just outside the 22. Campisi's there. Back to Brook. Clever thinking now to Bunce. Bunce straightens up beautifully. Australia there first through Manu. New Zealand clean out, coming back for Gregan. Here's Howard. Decides to have a go. Australia have it in control here. Now it's Burke inside his 22. And he takes play to within 9 metres of the halfway line.
The frustration showing on Matt Burke's face.
Score here, 5-3. And a knock on by Australia. 5-3 the score. And a New Zealand scrum tee just in Australia's half.
And Gordon, Jim Fleming showing he's playing that great Scottish advantage. He let it go on. A knock on from Eels trying to recover the ball tapped by the All Blacks. And he just let it flow for a while. And he then whistled it up just as Andrew Mertens break clear. So good refereeing.
Dr. John Best there, taking care of Michael Foley. He's obviously got a hit in the jaw. And Walter Little, he's a very strong player. Gregan, big hit over the top. Manu there to clean up.
Coach, wait. So this very experienced New Zealand front row. Nearly 140 test caps between them. Here's Brook. Marshall slips it back to Lomu. Howard's there. So too was Toms. Ball coming back for New Zealand. And Australia not staying on their feet. The ball was coming back there for New Zealand.
Well, this is simple stuff from the Australians. That was a very straightforward penalty, and no one could complain about that. David Wilson, the man who seems to be pointed out by Jim Fleming, could be mean one or two out there. Marshall takes the ball up. He finds Lomu. And Lomu, as always, two or three men trying to put him down. Now, this is where the referee says David Wilson's gone to the top. He gets a bit of advantage from his players pushing in. Probably a bit unlucky.
Daniel Herbert in picture there, stretching. All of the Wallaby reserves. Scott Bowen kneeling and Sammy Payne. Marco Caputo at the headgear, the reserve hooker. Keeping stretched and fresh. They could be needed at any moment.
Penalties 4-0 to New Zealand. Mertens right on target with his first kick. This is a similar attempt. Going to be close and just inside the left-hand uprights. So Andrew Mertens, who was off target last weekend against South Africa, although he got five penalties, he missed four. And New Zealand back in the lead.
Well, look at that wind coming through now. And this will work against the Australians in the second half. It's good to see the Australians in this game. They're really trying to get that ball wide. They ran into all sorts of problems in close against the All Blacks in Wellington, especially Jones and Cronfeld.
Michael Bryle charging after this one. Cronfeld's there. Got away from Bryle. Tremendous speed from the back rower. Campisi the tackler. Marshall lost it back. Lomu in close. Four or five men to bring him down. Good low drive there from New Zealand. They've lost it again. Morgan. Big charge from Garrick Morgan. 38 metres out. Foley now in close into Fitzpatrick, who tried to turn him over. Well, Gregan's kicked it. Here comes Campisi. It lands just inside the touchline. Here's Cullen. Australia had an opportunity to stretch New Zealand there. They'll still have the line out, 18 metres out.
Great poise shown on the wing. The man closing a high ball close to the line, caught, shaped up to the attacker and then moved it wide. Cullen did the work.
David Campisi, prominent in the early stages. Eels at the back. Great take by him. They turn him over. Eels trying to slip this one back. It's on the ground for Australia. New Zealand is offside there through Bunce. Referee plays advantage. Overlap here. Roth, Toms, Howards. Now it's Tune. Wilson goes into Morlett. New Zealand stretched again. 3 metres out. Australia edging it ahead. Here they go. Manu lost it. Oh, a huge let off there for New Zealand. Potential five-pointer goes begging.
It was there for the Wallabies. Daniel Manu, what a tragic mistake there, right on attack. Now, a very good clearing kick there from Justin Marshall. Gets the All Blacks out of the danger zone.
Robin Brook, sensational in Wellington. And against South Africa again, jumped well. Be using him a lot defensively. Foley again, Eels probably.
It's okay.
Coming back here for Gregan. Howard now. It's another Gary Owen. Coming down just inside the 22, Cullen. Thumped by Bryle, the referee says play on. No mark awarded, another chance for Australia. Morgan, Gregan, there's a big chance here. Howard came back the wrong way. Australia tried to set it up.
Leave it. Keep forward.
And Australia's lost it again. Just outside the 22. Now New Zealand with Cullen and space. Wilson. Gregan's across. Burke got in the way.
Terrible let off there for the Wallabies. Pat Howard just needed to get that ball to a support play, even by standing still. It was a great ball. You can't be tackled off the ground. His toe had just touched, so Jim Fleming thinks Bryle drove him and got the ball free.
Bryle does well at the back of the line out again. Howard into space. That's not a good kick. Straight to Christian Cullen. He wanted to wait that one a little less. Cullen doesn't get his touch. Here's Campisi. He follows. He's herring after it. Mertens now gets the mark.
And Andrew Merton staying on the ground that time, and he had the room to. And that's the safest way.
Come on, keep coming back.
Well, someone needs to get the message to the Australian backs very quickly. Keep the ball in hand. They've had success on early in this game via moving the ball through the hands, kicking it back to this very, very skillful back three. The All Blacks will get them nowhere.
Sorry? Well, the Australians signalled their message early on when the ball was moved wide. But they've had several opportunities to really put the acid on New Zealand. And the opportunity has slipped away. Scoreboard flattering for New Zealand at the moment. They lead 6-5. So
and we
it looks
see
as though there may be a break here for Garrick Morgan.
Tim Gavin on the sideline. Tim Gavin's right here and I'll probably attend to it. And there'll be a big roar for Tim Gavin. He's got a hand injury. It looks like a broken knuckle. Or thumb. Seems to be sticking out there. Dislocated maybe. It's broken. I don't think they'll let him come back on. He's having it looked at on the sideline by the doctor as play continues.
No, you belong to shoulders in the back. Number 4 play.
And against Ian Jones that time. And Australia gets its first penalty of the game. And it's come almost into the first quarter.
What a fantastic opportunity for Tim Gavin. He played his first test against the All Blacks in 1988. A draw in Brisbane. Inspirational player.
45th test match for Tim Gavin, the Waratah skipper. And he certainly has had a big impact at training during the week. It's 6-5 to New Zealand.
And we just heard it's a broken bone, I think, in the hand for Garrick Morgan, which is disappointing. I think the back of the index finger in the hand.
So Gavin should move to the second row to play alongside John Eales. Burke now with the breeze, 55-metre penalty attempt. Just to put Australia back in the lead. It's pretty close. A magnificent strike there by Matthew Burke. He's closing on 100 test points for the season as Australia goes back into the lead.
And the All Blacks fated to split their forwards across the field. Now they bring them all across to the left-hand side of the field. Mertens, he's a pinpoint kicker. And Tim Gavin will get right into this one.
And as you said, Gordon, always the master of understatement you are. This could be close. The crowd at the back of the base was willing it. Nearly sucking it over the goalpost because they know how much difference it'll make to this Wallaby team to keep their nose in front.
Well, Matthew Burke did a similar thing against South Africa to put Australia back in the lead. It was a huge boost, and Eales with superb athletic skills. Coming back for Gregan. Pat Howard just wanting to settle down as he takes play up towards the halfway line.
Ruck and maul count. Australia 14, New Zealand 13. That's a good stat. They need to keep up this work rate. John Eales, look at it. What great skills.
Eales opposed to Jones. He went high. Marshall and Mertens. Here comes Little and Bunce. He slowed up as he came to Toms. Australia very eager here at the tackle. And another penalty. Another chance for Matthew Burke. Not releasing.
Matthew Burke, 2 minutes ago, put one over from virtually the same distance. Frank Bunce not happy. It's surprising he slowed down coming into that tackle. Real hard man of world rugby out there in the centres.
Well, I applaud Greg Smith and his team for identifying this man and paying him special attention. He is the class centre in the world at the moment, even though he admits to 34 and a half years of age. And Australia are giving the attention and showing him the respect he deserves because he can cut you to pieces. But now this man has the opportunity to bring this stadium alive.
So Garrick Morgan must now watch from the touchline. A tragic blow for him. Fine tackle underneath by Richard Toms and a wrencher over the top by Pat Howard forced the error. Can Burke do it again and give Australia a 5-point lead? It's online. How close? Close enough. Matthew Burke. Australia out by 5.
There's still a gap the way the Northern Hemisphere referees are playing advantage down here as Burke slots this one over. Jim Fleming didn't really sort of talk to the players out there. Give him a chance to right the wrongs.
Here's Ben Tune taking it on his chest. He ran into Robin Brook. Australia stand their ground. Back to Howard. Trying a banana kick that time. Here's Zinzan Brook. And we're 11 metres from the halfway line. Australia ahead by 11-6.
Great competitor Zinny at the back. Need to lift this team of his. Not particularly concerned. They're a very professional outfit. They can do it in the wet, the dry. They can come from behind or in front. They can play a kicking game or a running game. Sean Fitzpatrick now needs to be right on the spot.
Robin Brook. Zinzan Brook comes in a low, strong leg drive here from New Zealand. Back from Fitzpatrick. Mertens now. Australian backs up quickly. Burke. Wilson comes through hard. Jeff Wilson, Burke couldn't take it. Campisi. And it was lost ahead there by the Australians.
Well, that was good refereeing. He played good advantage in that instance.
Wait, I'm going to come through.
Richard Harry asked for the mark. Precious scrum. All Blacks full on attack.
And well, he might. This is payback time. All Blacks are really cranking. They're inside that 22. Meet a must score zone. And they are focused now. Look at the setup in the backs. The scrum is low. The pressure must come from the Wallabies right at this pack. If they allow the All Blacks scrum to pack and get their own way, it could be a back row move or it could be a back line move that may tell.
Australia with a disrupted scrum. Tim Gavin coming into the second row. Cullen standing out on the right. New Zealand feeling they can edge this ahead. Zinzan Brook. Australia pins it on the ground there and they've conceded a penalty. They weren't on their feet.
Top of it.
Good call, Gordon. Referee Jim Fleming, Matthew Burke, part of the tackle, still hadn't regained his feet and reached over and picked up the ball from the All Black side and pulled it back over.
You must activate it quickly.
Good work there from the All Blacks, just trying to drag that Australian defence in. If the play had continued, obviously they have a few Wallabies short out wide. There's a chance then to inject the big guns, guys like Jana Lomu, Wilson, Christian Cullen.
So Andrew Mertens won't miss this one. He'll close the gap to within 2 points. Mertens has 3 penalty goals. Australia, a try by Gregan, and 2 3-pointers by Matthew Burke, enjoys that advantage of 2.
The Australians slowed down a bit in the last 5 minutes, need to pick up that tempo from the first 20. Get the wood well and truly back on the All Blacks.
Less than 12 minutes before half-time, Eels was there. Taken by Jones, that's Ian. Back for Fitzpatrick. Foley the tackler with Wilson. Brail mauling strongly and rucking vigorously. Australians, referee says play on. The ball was out. Gregan, chance for Australia. Bad pass there from Howard. Roth couldn't pick it up around his bootlaces. Lost ahead by New Zealand.
This is a slippery surface, as all players are showing. Campese even is unsteady on it. And all of a sudden there's little slips, but it was a very ordinary pass from Pat Howard. There's an opportunity there to capitalise, and now there's been that couple of times.
Hold it.
Hopefully he'll settle down. Won't take the option to run first and just move it on quickly.
Australian defence has been outstanding. Really making their tackles count. Can they maintain that? Merton's taking no risks, and a searching touch finder over halfway. That's a mighty kick to the 10-metre line.
And Simon, every time that Australia have looked dangerous, the All Blacks have just got the composure back and struck back downfield through the boot of Mertens.
Yeah, they've got a super defence out there. They organise, reorganise very quickly. Guys like Michael Jones, well, he's fast as the backs out there, and he hits harder.
He has
Jones,
been
Cronfeld,
he has been a little quiet, though, Simon, Michael Jones today. I think John Hart will be looking for a little more from him in the second half.
A lot of New Zealand supporters here. That's John Eales. Soaring. That's Harry. Straight through the centre of the All Black pack. Gregan. Brail. Charging. 15-metre gain for Michael Brail. And the referee has spotted a knock-on.
He lost the ball forward, Gordon, as he went to ground. He was trying to hook it round under his body. Maybe even pop up a pass. And as he hit on his elbow, it went forward.
Watch as he comes through here. Josh Cronfeld, he gets past him. Gets past David Wilson as a shield. Plenty of enthusiasm, but you've got to finish it off.
Well, if the Wallabies had taken their chances in this first half, their lead would be far greater than 2. And this is Andrew Heath. Score here, Australia 11, New Zealand 9.
Stop boring, being boring. I don't think there's too many real interesting ones out there in the front six. But here, Fleming right on top of it. Brown packs, comes in across on the hooker. Jim Fleming standing there watching it. He is around that side. He's obviously aware of something. He would normally be on the side where the put-in is. And Brown coming not only in and across, but also, I think, taking that to ground. The Auckland accountant penalised, and it could be costly.
Well, both coaches during the week having long talks with Jim Fleming, and obviously they pointed that out, Greg Smith, to Fleming. They're worried about that part of the game.
So Matthew Burke needs this to take him past 100 test points this season. And this is sixth international, but not to be. So we've seen a lot of turnovers from both sides. A lot of uncharacteristic mistakes from the All Blacks, but it's been forced by some tremendous defence. Mertens goes high. Here's Manu. Gavin was back to support. Grigan. Tune. Marshall the tackler. Wilson almost kept it in play.
Well, from here the touch judge couldn't see it, but the ball had been brought loose before the foot had crossed the line. I think a replay had probably shown, but it was a tough call on the touch judge.
No, please.
So now it's Sean Fitzpatrick, who brought up his 300 first-class games during the Super 12. Ian Jones at the front of the line-out here with Brooke. Back for Marshall and Mertens. Here's Little. Wilson the tackler, back to Cronfeld. Australia read it well. Quick phase ball for Lomu. Howard underneath. He got through that tackle. Eels was there. New Zealand clean-outs. Now it's Cronfeld and Wilson. Campisi. Ball and all tackle, and lost ahead there by Jeff Wilson. David Campisi, his farewell test in Australia.
Well, in the in the Olympic coverage, one of the boxing commentators said he thought one of the boxers thought defence was something that went round the house, but David Campisi is not in that class, and he really cleaned up Wilson there.
Solid Australian scrum. Howard. Tom's lost it. Slippery ball again. Back to Burke. He's beaten three tackles. Four. Tunes outside. Matthew Burke. It's got to be a try. Sensational efforts. It came from a spilled ball. Matthew Burke has run through half of the New Zealand team for a wonderful try here at Suncorp.
This guy has the goods, and crown yourself in Wallaby glory. That Gilbert ball has never looked prouder than on the head of this man. It came from a breakdown, and look at this. Standing start straight into top gear. They all tried the best in the world. Zinzan, Brook and Lomu. In came Cullen, and he still kept going. Look at this man go. You good thing, and all in Atlanta watching it, the Seven crew would love that moment.
Yes, and what a brave Simon Poitevin to bring up your 100 test points for the season.
Super stuff from Burke. He just couldn't believe it. He got through that defence, especially Cronfeld and Zinzan Brook, two of the game's best defenders. Lomu got a bit lost out wide, and Chin was there to score the try if Burke had been caught.
And there'd be some very proud boys at St. Joseph's College, because during the week, Matthew Burke presented the first 15 with their jerseys in that ritual that takes place in the Assembly Hall. Greg Smith, the Australian coach, fighting back a semblance of a smile at the moment, but Australia out by seven, and it could well have been a lot more.
Matthew Burke, the hard part now. Put this over from the sideline. It's a tough kick.
Look at that chest heaving.
He's pushed it just out to the right. So New Zealand, trailing by a converted try, Alan Border approves.
The great AB standing there, that try scored right in front of him in the grandstand. And he would have loved the moment, and it would have been even better had Burke been able to convert his own try. As they tell a story about scoring a try in a test match here and then missing the kick.
Here's Daniel Manu underneath. Robin Brook was there, lost ahead by Fitzpatrick, but the first knock on by Australia. This telecast going around the world, B Sky B in Great Britain, TVNZ and Sky TV in New Zealand, Mnet Super Sports in South Africa and Star TV in Southeast Asia.
And Will Carling, Simon, having millions of fans here in Australia now. He spoke at a big lunch in Brisbane yesterday, and he did such a wonderful job. All those in B Sky B, take your cap off to him. He's a great ambassador for your country.
May not help his chances in the England squad, though.
He said that exactly yesterday.
Longu. And balking there by the referee. Grigan plays on. Is Manu. Daniel Manu taken high.
Well, Justin Marshall, the perpetrator of the high tackle. Manu's a tough boy. Wouldn't worry him. I'd be surprised if Jim Fleming does walk Marshall here. Watch, he throws Mertens down and Marshall goes high.
That's a tough call. He had to leap high. But look at this from the big man, Manu. He's just swatted him like a fly, a black fly. And then Justin Marshall jumping up into the tackle. That wasn't dangerous. It was high. Good decision, Mr. Referee. And Australia striking back as we close on the first half.
Well, Australia was penalised 4-0 in the early stages. But it's now back to 5-all. And there's Tim Horan with, we believe, a couple of fractures in that nose after that mishap at training.
I'm sure there's plenty of banter going between Tim Horan and Jason Little. They both copped very nasty facial injuries this year. And especially Jason Little, who likes his looks.
They both look like props sitting there. Simon, it looks like, here's Manu. Look at him swat off Mertens. And Justin Marshall, he has to jump. He's looking away. And I think that first point of contact was on the shirt and then the arm wrapped around with the momentum of Manu. But Timmy Horan, as you say, that black under the eyes, looking like he's prepared for one of those night games under lights. Bad break, and I think a couple of teeth pushed back up into the gum as well.
Well, Daniel Manu, formerly from Penrose High School in Auckland, and six of his former Auckland teammates are in that All Black side today. Michael Jones, the Brook brothers, Dowd, Brown and Fitzpatrick. Jonah Lomu has been grassed. A brilliant tackle early on by Ben Tune. A huge psychological strike by the Australians. 50 metres to go here. We're right on half time. It's a big kick for Burke. Has he got the distance? Shaving the left hand uprights. The hooter goes. So at the break here at Suncorp Stadium, this Tri-Nations match between Australia and New Zealand has been a thriller. And a converted try separates the two sides. Australia 16, New Zealand 9. Well, if Australia wins this game, at the end, we'll be looking for a turning point, and it will be this. Magnificent 80-metre individual effort, reminiscent of the great Sean Serge Blanco back at Ballymore in the early 90s when he went length of the field. So the halftime score here, 16-9 to the Australians.
And the stats, let's walk through them. Amazingly, five scrums only during the game, the rucks and mauls favouring the Australians. Fly halves really mixing up there, a lot of counter-attack in this game, which is great to see. And Jim Fleming, only five penalties, that's a really good performance compared to last week's debacle at Christchurch.
And Chris Handy, two very animated coaches during the break. So here we go. Here's Brook coming through. Foley picks up. Wrapped up there by Michael Jones, who sends him back metres in the tackle. New Zealand try to turn him over. Driving ahead. And scrum feed goes to the All Blacks. That's the start they wanted.
Yes, certainly the start that John Hart would have instilled into his side. Stung by this really big onslaught by the Australians in the first half. And the All Blacks will hit back.
And Simon, from John Hart at halftime, you have to score tries, but you've got to want it badly enough. And they're like savage Bolton. Words from...
Here's Cullen. Campisi got him ball and all. And he lost a head. Well, again, a very big scrum there from New Zealand. They kept the pressure on Australia. But David Campisi read it superbly.
Great timing here from David Campisi. Watch, he stands still, moves in on Cullen. Cuts his options down and the ball is spilt. Now Australia must have a steady scrum here. Get themselves out of this danger zone.
And Michael Brayle assisting Campisi there. Gee, he's taking their space. And he's making it personal. As are all of these Wallabies. But don't underestimate this black team. They are the best. But they're going to have to work really hard against this inspired Wallaby team now.
Ball is out!
Oh, that's not a great kick from Gregan. It's gone straight up in the air. Wilson lost a head. And we'll have another scrum. So composure needed all round here.
Yeah, Grant Fox made the point before the game, the great New Zealand fly half, that Australia lacked a lot of kicking power at halfback and a fly half. And that's proving correct during this game.
So the referee telling the front rowers here, Chris, to keep their hands off the ground. It's been a technique of New Zealand's.
It has. Craig Dowd either does that or he puts his arm back onto his leg, which he is allowed to do. But you can't put your hand on the ground. You must take the bind, either on the opposition's jersey or as a loose head, you can put your arm on your leg to support you. Andrew Heath obviously must be taking a bit of toll on Craig Dowd, although it's not obvious in the scrum stats.
Good hit there by the Australians at the engagement. Richard Harry doing well. Ryle now. Wilson arrives.
He's on, not offside. He's got offside.
New Zealand tight forwards just a little bit slow to get onside. Cronfeld right on the offside line there. Howard pumping it up the touchline to Cullen. Nicely weighted kick. He can arrive here as the ball does. Eels back to Ryle. Big charge into Fitzpatrick. Regan now wants it. New Zealand killing the ball, playing it on the ground.
Well, as we say, they advertise the rugby game in the USA. Trample the weak, hurdle the dead. And Australia stepping up now. They're really working hard in their support play.
Great covering by Michael Bryle back there, as a number eight should be doing, to pick that ball up. John Eels shielding our fullback there, taking the pain.
John Eels at the back. Gregan did well to Howard. Tom's now straightening. Zinzan Brook, the tackler. This is Gregan. Campisi's there. Wilson arrives. And so does the Australian pack.
Okay, back here, please. Great work from Gregan to keep that ball available. Trying to work himself to support the man. He kept the ball available and poked it through and held it up off the ground.
Back 10. Here's a mark here.
Referee's found a technical infringement here against New Zealand. And is now telling them to retire their 10 metres.
And the use of that short arm penalty should be used more often. We saw against South Africa, New Zealand penalised a lot of times with a full arm penalty. And I think the short arm is a good use.
Sean Fitzpatrick coming in with his shoulder there to try and disrupt, but the Australians have marched to 10. They're still going. And New Zealand has to be careful they don't collapse it.
Well, that was a shocker. And it was Michael Jones, of all people, coming through and collapsing that maul.
Number six.
Craig Dowd needing all of them. Watch, Fitzpatrick has just driven into Richard Harry, but he's just pushing him aside, and they're still going forward. But Fitzpatrick is just sneaking in the back of the Australian maul there, and Robin Brook has a little slap at Richard Harry.
Score, Australia 16, New Zealand 9. At the moment here at Suncorp Stadium, he's kicked just 2 from 6. But the Wallabies would dearly love this one to give them a 10-point lead. A better looking strike, and it bisects the uprights. So Australia out to a 19-9 advantage, and we've had 5 minutes in the second half.
Well, that one really hurts the All Blacks. A vital 3 early points there for the Wallabies, and now the gap even greater for the All Blacks to come in and try and make it up. And they don't need to play too much panic catch-up rugby, but they are running out of time.
Well, Brook was very close to being in front of the kicker there. He got away with it. So very good skills from him. Timing it perfectly. Here's Mertens. A tester now for Burke. Little coming through. So is Cullen. Burke! Oh, that was amazing.
Not only the jump, but the call also. Smart enough to call a mark as Campisi clears the ball out. And that's a huge kick down to halfway.
That's the composure shown by the All Blacks in the first half. Australia picking it up, Simon.
What an athlete, Matthew Burke. He's shown all the skills here this afternoon, and we're 5 metres into Australian territory. Johnny Eels working there with number 3, Heath. Now opposed to Ian Jones. Eels got it. Brilliant play by the Australian skipper. Back for Manu. Foley arrives. Arnie needs a bit of support here. Cregan now. Back for Brial, they were waiting for him. Jones was there, so was Brook. Offside play there by number 7. The ball was reefed out. And the referee rules a knock-on against Australia.
Well, the wrong options then by the Wallabies. They should have been sending this ball wide. Michael Brial. You know, Michael Jones, Zinzan Brook. You're not going to get past that easy without wide. You've got Campese, you've got Tune, you've got Burke.
Here's Cullen. Cregan the tackler. Cullen had to release. Wilson arrived. And it looks as though Cullen may not have released the ball. And it was George Cregan again, right round the ankles.
Gordon, there's not a better pound-for-pound tackler in the game. And I say that he may not have great strength in his kicking game. There's been some criticism about the speed of his clearance. But in defence, he is just sensational and such balance. The All Blacks wondering now where they're going to go. They've tried a couple of options.
Heels again. Howard. Toms. Well, it was all slow motion. Roth gets away from a tackle low. Manu supports. Australia go again here. 38 metres out. Cronfeld. Referee says the ball was out. Now New Zealand has an overlap. Mertens kicks. Campese back. So is Burke. Bounce is favourable. And that's a grand kick by Burke. Look at that angle. A real banana.
Landry Mertens, he can kick like that all game. Please do, without on the outside, Jeff Wilson and Walter Little. Virtually unmarked. And it was the wrong option. They had the Australians reeling.
And Matthew Burke can do no wrong. It is Sunday tomorrow. But I think here in Brisbane they might be worshipping this man, Matt Burke. And not the Almighty, although that's not such a great thing. Zinzan Brook concentrating.
Richard Harry quickly to Cregan. Howard and Toms now. Cronfeld the tackler. Here they go. Line side to Roth. Foley's out there. The kick was out on the full.
Well, Joe Roth mistaking Michael Foley out there in the wing. He wouldn't have put that chip kick ahead, I think, if he saw it was Foley. That's all that goal jumper.
That's what they all said with me outside, Gordon. They threw it to my hip, not in front of me, because I was always running as fast as I could. The same thing with Foley, and I thought your comment, keep the ball in hand, might have been the option.
Great pick up there by Marshall. Zinzan Brook taken by Howard. 3 metres into Australian territory. New Zealand come ahead, but they kick away again. Again, the soccer skills from Burke. Well, it's a throwback to his days with the Carlingford Redbacks between ages 4 and 10. It was all soccer in those days, and he is white hot.
They have just lost their poise for the moment, the All Blacks, and they must get it back. And I don't think by kicking the ball away will be the option. They've got to be able to use it. They're a fantastic attacking team at pace. They've got to get ball in hand more often and use it.
Ian Jones came to the front. It's a wrestle.
The All Blacks seem almost spooked by this Australian defence. Going for the kick way too often.
Yes, New Zealand certainly have lacked composure today. They need this game to wrap up the Tri Nation series. Australia has to win it to stay alive. South Africa desperately wants a Wallaby victory. Eels again. Barging in the line out against the Wallabies.
Well, it's a hot contest out there in this line out. And Jim Fleming saw plenty of interference there on the All Black jumpers.
It was obviously going to go to Jones and the blockers coming across the line. But it was his own man, I think, that prevented him from getting in and up at the ball.
That's a nice kick, taking play down to the 22. So now the blowtorch comes out from New Zealand. Australia by 10. And we've had just over 11 minutes in this second half.
The Kiwis opting for the short line out here. Jones and Brook. The two options.
Heels again. He has been absolutely sublime in the lineouts. Campese called for it. It was well read though by Marshall. Foley's there. Still in play.
May well be one of those calls David Campese regrets, because it was the option, but he got swarmed by black jerseys.
The referee there rules the scrum feed for New Zealand. Still up in a maul. So some good work there by the scrum half, Justin Marshall. Wilson's come in. Outside ball's a little here. Good attacking platform here for the All Blacks. Mertens. Here's Lomu. Howard got him. On the 22. New Zealand back row hasn't been as fast today. They've lost it again. Gregan.
Oh, lucky. Lucky for the Australian side there. The first knock on by the All Blacks, and George Gregan also spilling the ball. Now the Australians have a chance to clear the ball.
The All Blacks leaving Jan Lomu isolated. He's hitting the ball up. Then he's there with the ball. He almost has to hold on to it more. And there he trying to retain it until the boys arrive.
Come on, gentlemen.
And in doing so, lost it forward.
Australian back row working superbly here. Simon Poitevin, David Wilson continually winning that race to the breakdown.
Yeah, David Wilson, he doesn't see a lot of him out in the open, but I'll tell you what, in tight there, he's doing a mountain of work and ably helped by Manu and Braille.
Important scrum here for the Wallabies. The edge ahead here, it goes through the 90 degrees. So we're in centre field on the 22. Australia leading by 19-9. 27 minutes to go.
You're pushing before the ball comes in, Black.
The referee ruling there that New Zealand pushing over the mark before the ball comes into the scrum. You have to hold the weight on the engagement. And Australia, because they're inside their 22, can kick this free kick out on the full.
Look at this man, Ollo Brown and Craig Dowd, the other side. And they've been tested in these scrums.
Here's Mertens. Marshall and Little. Bunce. Lomu's outside. Lomu knocks on. Christian Cullen was away. Nothing going right for Jonah today.
Well, Jonah Lomu's boots sold yesterday at auction here in Brisbane for $6,500. But fellow might be regretting his purchase looking at this. He is a great player. He brought injury into the game, and maybe the decision from John Hart should have been maybe not to play him.
Here's Richard Toms getting over the advantage line. Australia want quick ball here. Gregan goes himself, rubbering through now for Tune. Marshall sockers into touch 15 metres out.
Great option from Gregan. Were five All Black defenders out there, one Australian attacker in Ben Tune. He's found the gap. The ball's been put out by the All Blacks, and now Foley has the throw.
And we have the first ever 40,000 plus crowd for a rugby game here in Brisbane. It's a sellout. Australia ahead 19-9.
Not too many free tickets around Brisbane this week.
John Eales and Michael Braille that time. The Australians really pumped up here. Good communication in the forwards. Gregan now. Howard. Roth went without it. And New Zealand collapsing them all. The referee played the advantage. And this could really hurt if Burke can slot it.
Well, this is really damaging the All Black forward morale. Jim Fleming has been unrelenting with this pulling down. The game's changed. You cannot deliberately collapse a ruck or a maul.
Australia with the kick to come, leading by 19-9. That the All Blacks have really shown the effects of that mentally and physically exhausting game against the Springboks last week. They have been a little flat today, and the Wallabies have taken it to them and gone straight for the jugular.
Gordon, you're so right. They struggled away from home. South Africa did when they came here. Australia did when they went to Wellington. The All Blacks are here out of their normal atmosphere, but I think that'll make the rest of their tour very focused. This isn't one that they would have liked to have missed, but the travel that they go through these days in Super 12 and also Tri-Nation, which makes these games fantastically opportune, really takes its toll.
Well, John Hart really eased off on the training leading into the game. New Zealand's training on Wednesday was the best John Hart had seen as coach this season, but they haven't taken it out on the field here today. Huge kick here for Burke. The crowd will tell you, and it's a happy reaction. Another penalty goal for Burke, his fourth. Mertens has kicked three. Australia has scored 2-0. And the lead, 22-9.
They're the biggest part of the huge crowd here. Great kick from Burke, sitting in behind, watching it, just coming in from that outside post, and there was 40,167 very happy hearts here.
Foley takes it. Michael Jones came up. Good driving maul here from the Australians. Harry's there. And Josh Kronfeld ruled offside. The referee said there was a maul form.
Well, I think it was marginal. Josh Kronfeld on his feet.
He's a great player. Just inspiring in the Athletic Park test, and he really called it good.
No touch there for Australia. Cullen kicks straight back to Burke, who gets a second bite here for his team. Now this is Walter Little. Mertens. Marshall and Brook. Lomu's outside. Here comes Toms on Walter Little. And the referee has ruled the Australians offside.
You can't be played on by a pass. You must meet your plate on.
People who were in front of the kicker there had to be put onside. And Matthew Burke down for attention.
The All Blacks very indecisive today. And here it is, the hit by Walter Little. Richard Toms hitting him hard, but all to no avail. The penalty had taken place.
So those players were ruled offside, those Australian players, as Burke has fallen very awkwardly, but he's up and okay. Now Andrew Heath has gone down for some attention here, but if you're in front of the kicker, you have to be run onside. 22-9, Australia leads.
Troubles with his neck, I think, just in this game, and Greg Craig talking to him. I think he's having a little trouble with vision and things as well, so he's really putting in the grunt. It's not easy against Craig Down. He really brings it to you. Sister Christie in the convention centre in Wellington really helped us.
So taken by Robin Brook. Jones drives in. John Eales comes in for the tackle. Eales has produced one of his greatest games in the Wallaby jumper this afternoon.
Well, tough decision here for Sean Fitzpatrick. Looks as though he's going to go for the goal. Still a fair amount of time left in this game. 20 minutes.
13 points the difference. So this would close it to 10. And he is 13 metres in from this main grandstand touchline. Michael Bryle, who has worked extremely well, complimenting David Wilson and Daniel Manu. And all of the Australians really have a point to prove here today after being humiliated at Athletic Park, their worst ever test loss by 43-6. The scoreboard has been reversed here today. 19 and a half minutes to go. Australia 22-9. Burton's looking for his fourth penalty, and it's another beautiful strike by this young man from Canterbury, who missed all of the Super 12 because of a serious knee injury.
So John Eales, John Eales has got to get this Australian side focused on continuing to attack in this last 20 minutes. They cannot try and defend the lead. They must continue to put pressure on the All Blacks.
John Hart said at halftime, we must score tries. And although they've got that penalty, that still rings in my ears. He's a very astute judge, and he knows his team when they're scoring tries are in top form.
Ian Jones, Josh Kronfeld, picked up by Marshall. He links up with Ollie Brown. 15 metres from halfway. New Zealand now to really come at the Australians, but a fine tackle by Eales. Supported by Ian Jones that time. Mertens in the scrum half. Lomu threw on Campisi.
And Lomu was a mile or side. That kick through a good 2 metres.
Well, Jim Fleming may have missed that particular one, and David Campisi might luckily have
had that comfort of the sideline. He's played really well today. That's the kick.
Taken by Brook. And brother Zinzan comes in. Zinzan at the back of this maul. This is the best driving maul we've seen from New Zealand. Australia has to be careful they don't collapse it. They've been penalised, so the referee being consistent. And another three-point opportunity.
That was a good consistent call from Jim Fleming, and if not the collapse, certainly Michael Foley then coming in and lying on top of the ball. John Eales in there, going hard. Now here we see Foley's lying all over the ball. They've had the boot going into Fitzpatrick's head as well. Well,
Simon, he was penalised for pulling the man down, and the man was free driving forward, and he tackled him, and they went to ground. Now, yes, he did lie over, but referee Jim Fleming did say pulling the man down,
yes,
and collapsing them all, and I feel that was not the right decision.
Well, I think the point you're making there, Chris, is if there's a maul formed, you can't pull it down, but just a doubt there whether there was a maul. But it's all history, because Andrew Mertens has the opportunity for his fifth penalty goal, and this would bring New Zealand back to within a converted try. The Australians making mistakes and conceding penalties, and they're being punished by this sharpshooter, Andrew Mertens. 22 Australia, 15 New Zealand, and we have 16 and a half minutes to go.
Well, five from Fry for Mertens, and the All Blacks will be hungry for a try. Ian Jones, he's been outstanding today in the line-out, as has David Wilson in the loose.
Well, if the Kieran Perkins got the same encouragement that these gold jerseys were getting now, he must have been inspired. Everyone is just cheering, come on, gold.
Here's Zinzan Brook into Gavin. On the 22. New Zealand now sensing that they're right back in this game. There's Mertens across field. Here comes Burke, the bounce important. Burke again with another amazing kick, but it didn't go into touch. Yes, it did, says Ken McCartney on the far side. Well, it's Ray Megson over there.
And Gary Taylor, the photographer in the back there, he sort of doubted it too by his movement. But that's what Ken McCartney's there for. And the player had his foot on the line when he touched the ball, so that's a good call.
The question is then, why do the All Blacks get the throw in?
Yes.
Lost a head there by Robin Brook. So Australia will get a scrum 15 metres in. And just 7 points in it. It's shaping as a nail-biting finish to this game. Australia has to win.
Australian forwards have got to take control, and Pat Howard has got to be spot on. If he passes it, it's got to be quickly. If he kicks, it has to be decisive.
Get in, hold up!
Here's Richard Toms running hard and straight. Cronfeld coming through. Joe Roth takes on Fitzpatrick. Brook was up there.
Okay, back you go.
New Zealand sent back onside. Here's Gregan again. Here's Cullen and Campisi. Flash of bodies, dangerous tackle. He was still in the air, says the referee, and Campo came off second best there.
No, I think he's called a mark. David Campisi, really, he sacrificed the body in that tackle.
I think he's winded there, Simon. He really hit badly. And
so plenty of drama here at Suncorp. Australia clinging to a 7-point lead, 22-15. Against New Zealand for obstruction. Zinzan Brook caught the ball, but a man in front of him obstructed Matthew Burke coming through. So the seesaw continues, Australia with a chance to add 3 points.
This is a clever tactic used by most nations. When a player receiving the ball by just passing in front of him at the last minute, it really makes it difficult to get at the ball carrier. And there the replay of the Campisi tackle on Cullen that winded David Campisi.
Yes, he certainly did appear to be in the air there, Christian Cullen.
Well, Craig Dowd was the player who put the obstruction there for Zinzan Brook. And just sort of try and loiter around there and give you a catch of some protection, but that time Jim Fleming too smart for it. And so here he is, Matthew Burke.
one of the heroes of the game so far. The Australian bench looking very pensive.
And we just heard on the sideline from our floor manager that there's some report of a bomb going off in Atlanta. Hopefully everything is well there, but there'll be a bomb go off here if Matthew Burke can kick this goal.
He's done it tough today with his goal kicking, just 4 from 8. They haven't been easy. It looks pretty good. A telling strike there by Burke. And the margin back to double figures.
This is so important, the double figures margin. 10 points now. That converted try. Now they're not there for New Zealand. Burke just swings it in.
So back now with Andrew Mertens. Brook chases hard. Manu's there. Ball was knocked back. Foley down on the loose ball. Harry goes into scrum half. He played for the Victorian under 14 team as a scrum half. Finally, Gregan took it. Here's Cullen. Nasty bounce. Loves to attack. There's that sidestep. Straight through. Great platform for New Zealand. Lomu's out here. Lomu away. Howard went for him. 4 Australians there. 15 metres out. New Zealand need their first try. Marshall. There it is.
Justin Marshall. Well, he's got to buy Jonah Lomu a drink after the game. Non-alcoholic, of course. He had 6 Australian defenders around him on the ground. And it gave Justin Marshall, look at the pile-up around Lomu, and George Gregan trying to mark the winger as well. And Justin Marshall, he's all class, this player. Gets across for a crucial try for New Zealand.
And it is crucial. They stretched the Wallabies and they did it well. And this guy has come on the scene internationally this year. He is special. And they'll need him. And look at the support they've got here in Brisbane. They've got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of All Black supporters here, some on their way to South Africa and some who've come specially just for this game.
So many test matches between the New Zealanders and the Australians in recent years. 1 point difference.
Now Mertens with the attempted conversion. He's happy. So it's a cliffhanger now. 10 minutes to go. Australia 25, New Zealand 22. Test of character for both sides.
10 minutes left on the clock. It's going to be fantastic, this 10.
Well, we come to expect these pulsating finishes from these two sides. There's Ben Tune, snaps it away from Zinzanbrook. A piece of inspiration. Howard puts it high. Campisi's coming through. Cullen's there. Campisi! And the mark is awarded.
David Campisi just misjudged his jump then. He couldn't quite get there. Went too early.
Now it's back to Mertens. Looking for a big one downfield and he gets it. He's Roth. Burke in support. Jones ahead, so is Mertens. Joe Roth with a big thump. There's no one at fullback here for New Zealand. Here's Zinzanbrook. And he'll force it down and play back to the 22. The players are very tired. 9.5 minutes to go. Australia 25, New Zealand 22. Mertens goes long again. Just kicking it away from Matthew Burke. Inside his 22, he's running it back up towards halfway. Chip and chase. Here's trouble, Fitzpatrick. New Zealand has a big line out on the open side. Marshall kicked again. Campisi inside his 22. Here's Zinzanbrook.
Oh, the touch judge McCartney's got Campisi back there.
Here's Lomu as play goes on. He threw the ball away, picked up by Little. Howard the tackler. Now it's Fitzpatrick. Australia in trouble here. New Zealand sensing they can pull it out of the fire. Marshall, Little, and Cullen. 3 Wallabies there. Cullen threw it backwards. It went into touch.
Currently the most dangerous man in Test rugby, Christian Cullen, in a situation like that. The Wallaby defence swarm.
Gregan, Harry, Campisi. No one was going to miss. Look at that juggernaut. This is desperate stuff. This is Test rugby in it. That's absolute best.
The dramatic stuff, all right. Watch this hit on Fitzpatrick. As Timmy Gavin comes across the top, he's copped plenty in the pass from Fitzpatrick. Copped that one back.
Great work there from the New Zealand skipper, though, to take that ball ahead twice.
And Fitzpatrick, the great competitor he is, taps Timmy Gavin on the side of the face and says, well done, lad. I'll get you next time. He is a great leader, a great sense of humour, particularly being up there in the front three, but no one's joking out there at the moment. This is serious.
Australia inside their 22. It's an Australian throw, I would have thought.
Will be a boardroom meeting on this one. And it goes to Australia.
Well, it was a good try, Sean.
He will keep trying.
John Eales. New Zealand tried to spoil. It's come down to ground here. Here's Gregan. Heaving it back over his left shoulder. Wilson. That's a penalty. He was in the air. You can't tackle the man when he's up off the ground.
And this could decide it, Gordon. It was a great kick by Gregan. They should have left him alone because he would have gone into touch. And Manu coming to him and tackling him in the air. It's a definite penalty.
So this one to level the scores. Here it comes. The penalty infringement.
Well, tragic stuff. McCartney was pointing out to the referee. We couldn't hear him speaking that Sean Fitzpatrick during that line-out was an absolute mile offside. But play goes on and Mertens has a chance to draw the game.
One wonders where the advantage stops or starts from that offside in the line-out. Clearly Australia, the back's against the wall once again.
What a pressure kick here for Andrew Mertens. 45 metres out, a metre in from touch. It's going to be very close. Scraping outside the upright. Campisi. He's still going. Courageous play from Campisi. Here's Brook. Now it's Mertens. Back to Zinzan Brook. He wants to keep it in play. Campo with Australian rule skills that time, just slowing things down. Staying inside his 22 and getting a big touch. Over halfway.
Well, David Campisi's made some important kicks in his time. That was in the top 10 for sure. He needed to find touch, he did. And New Zealand back on the halfway.
And David Campisi getting great encouragement from the crowd here. They really agree with everything he's doing today.
Michael Jones got it. New Zealand come again now. The All Black juggernauts. Mertens. Butts. Just caught. Wilson arrives. Can Australia steal it? The penalty goes against the Australians again for playing it on the ground. Another chance for Mertens. 50 metres out. Another chance to level the scores.
And like Cronfeld, David Campisi, with good reason to argue, David Wilson rather, are on their feet trying to get at the ball, the player controlling it as he's able. And it took the referee to make the decision, and this, again,
back on the 10.
Puts us back to the wall.
So it's 53 metres out. Mate. 4¾ minutes to go. We've had just the 6 draws in the history of Australia-New Zealand test matches since 1903. New Zealand playing their 151st test match away. They've won 100 of those, and now Mertens can make himself a hero. He's got the distance. Looks pretty good. New Zealand supporters are up. 25 all with 4 minutes to go. Australia, remember, led by 22-9.
I tell you what, there's a lot of New Zealand support in this Suncorp Stadium. They're everywhere.
If you had to have somebody kicking for you at this stage in the game, internationally, this is to be the bloke you'd want to take that kick.
There's Matthew Burke. Australia hearing through. Ian Jones. Good security there from his teammates. Can the All Blacks keep going now and overtake the Australians?
I'm coming. Held up.
Held up. Australian scrum feeds. 25 metres out.
Fantastic work by Timmy Gavin in there. Very strong upper body. Tied the ball up. Now the Australians have a chance. The hit back in this last 3 minutes and 18 seconds.
Australia have got to control the ball and keep it up in this territory. No mistakes coming in this side. They've got to keep this scrum nice and solid. They'll force Gregan to take it on their own. That's the wheel of the scrum. The All Blacks wheeling it into the sideline, cutting off a couple of options for George Gregan. They don't want him to get it. Don't want him to be able to get the ball wide. They'll have to be very careful here. Richard Harry extended Olive Brown, really going at him, but Harry's been great. Andrew Heath will have to tent peg and stop Craig Dowd from coming up on that side of the scrum.
Give it up, give it up, give it up.
So back for Gregan. Howard's caught by Cronfeld, 22. Ryle arrives.
Now control the ball.
Here's Gregan and Campisi. Drop goal. Pushes it out to the right. It was there for the taking.
David Campisi scrambled into position there to try and put that one over. Probably a bit rushed. Pat Howard taking the ball up to set the platform.
The ball didn't drop from his hands properly. It was nearly level with the horizontal with the ground.
So here's Ben Tune. He was driven back in the tackle. And it's a scrum feed for New Zealand. The All Blacks now have a last-ditch chance.
And do we see a Rob Andrew repeated here? Scrum far side, similar position to England when they played the Wallabies. Merton's in form, not a lot of time left on the clock. Enough to score a try, and Merton's out of the back of his hand, I think, says, I'll have a go. Great scrum.
Here we go, Sinzan Brook.
Just bring it closer to the centre of the field. This may be it.
Can New Zealand do it here? It looks like it. Cullen! Gregan! He tripped over. Did he release? It's a try! New Zealand have snatched it at the death and have clinched the Tri-Nation Series.
What a sensational effort by the All Blacks. When we thought they'd go to field goal, they went for the try. Such is the professionalism and the confidence of this team. They've hauled themselves back. John Hart said, you've got to do it with tries. And right on the bell, they've just broken every Australian heart, not only here at the ground, but in Australia and watching in Atlanta. Merton's the organiser, the absolute wizard who brings that man Cullen into the line. Gregan couldn't save it this time, although the swinging arm nearly did. He left it on the ground. There was no knock on. Bunce over.
Well, you're right, Butter. It really hurts being an Australian here at Suncorp Stadium. A beautifully worked move. Mertens loops around. George Gregan across, goes too high. And there's no doubt, with Jim Fleming right on the spot there, that Bunce got this ball down. David Campisi tries his best. But unfortunately for Australian supporters here and all around the world, we're done.
And New Zealand has clinched the Tri-Nation Series. Time is up on the clock. Two tries to Australia in the first half. And it really has been a brave fight back by New Zealand. The hooter goes. That really is one of the great comeback victories for Australia. Well, one they'll really rue because they had it in control for so long. But this great fighting spirit of New Zealand has seen them through by 32 to 25. New Zealand support here in great strength, and they are elated with this performance. But the Wallabies can be proud too, because they really took the game to New Zealand. And I guess when they look back at the tape, they'll realise that it was one that they should have put away.
Well, what a turnaround for the Wallabies after that absolute debacle in Wellington. Jana Lomu had a big part in today's game. But it's a game the Wallabies should have won. They had so many opportunities out there. They had a terrific lead. But New Zealand all skill, they worked their way back. They're off to South Africa for 4 test matches against the Springboks. It's a big ask. And they'll go with big confidence after this win here today at Suncorp Stadium in Brisbane.
Yes, contrasting camps. New Zealand's hard work has really paid off. And the thing about this side that makes them so great is that they didn't play well today. They didn't play well against South Africa, but they got the points in both games. Yes, the devastation for the Australian team. The Australians doing so well in that game, ahead at half-time by 16-9. It got out to 22-9. But the never-say-die New Zealanders, Simon, in the end, deserve their victory.
Well, Sean Fitzpatrick, he's been through plenty of dramatic games, as is David Campese out there. But for Fitzpatrick, now what a glorious win for him and David Campese, the absolute shattering experience of having this game in Australian hands and suddenly to see it slip out of their grasp as New Zealand fought back with a lot of dramatic try in the last minute.
Okay, we'll be back to wrap up here at Suncorp. Final score, New Zealand 32, Australia 25. That really was the great escape. Down 22-9, let's go to Chris Handy.
Patrick, what a wonderful day for the All Blacks. They hung in and hit back. The Wallabies just absolutely devastated by that try on the bell.
Well, they'd have to be, you know, with 10 minutes to go, we were out of the match, and they locked us out. Maybe they went a bit defensive in that last 10 minutes, but I'm just thrilled with the guys' attitude and the way we stuck at it, and the way the Aussies came at us for over 70 minutes of that game. What a wonderful game. I bet they've never seen a game like this at Suncorp Stadium.
Well, Australia hadn't been lucky at Suncorp Stadium. Only 3 times they played here for 3 losses.
Well, yeah, it's better than our record at Ballymore anyway, and of late anyway. And yeah, enjoyable game. You know, we've got a bit of work to do before we play the Africans again. And that's, you know, that's what we're looking forward to.
Thanks, Sean. Enjoy the night and the moment.
Thank you.
Yes, he really is a marvellous campaigner, Simon, and full credit to New Zealand. But I think the Australians would be kicking themselves, wouldn't they?
Oh, they would be ready to slash their wrists. They really deserve to win that game. A lot of missed opportunities during the game. It's interesting with the stats, look at the stats, that scrums even, lineouts even, and virtually ruck and maul even as well. So the side, fly halves using a lot of ball out there, mixed it up during the game. But if you had stats of missed opportunities, the Australians had about 10 where they should have done something and they didn't.
Yes, well, at the moment, the crowd just enjoying the scene here, but let's go back to Chris Handy with Jana Lomu.
Jana Lomu, what a great moment, and here one of your great mates, Daniel Manu, you've swapped jerseys. It was a great day for the All Blacks. They didn't give in.
Oh, definitely didn't. You know, the guys just went out there, you know, had nothing else to lose. You know, we were behind and we had to chuck everything at them, and we were just lucky.
You had an injury before the game. Did it bother you during it?
First couple of minutes it did, but you know, after that, you know, once the pressure was on, you know, it just all disappeared. And you know, like, you know, with the atmosphere around you, you know, you can't have time to think about injuries.
Well, congratulations and good luck in South Africa. It's going to be tough.
Thanks a lot. We're going to need it.
And Daniel Manu, the ecstasy and the agony. I said to John Eel, you had some great moments out there, and it must have been just terrible to lose it right at the last.
Yeah, I suppose just test football. You know, you've got to keep it on for 18 minutes. There's a team that plays for 18 minutes that wins it. You know, so maybe we're lacking a bit of experience in that department, but you know, the guys did well to get up on top in the beginning. You know. We just sort of lost it in the end, and well, it was good for the All Blacks to come back.
Well, just a drink tonight, and that's all you can be.
Oh, quiet drink and a bit of reflection on what could have been.
Good on you, mate. Thank you.
Thank you.
So there it is, Daniel Manu, but yes, congratulations to this New Zealand side. It really was a fantastic performance by them to come back from that deficit, and they have won the Tri Nations table. They've also won the Bledisloe Cup. Australia and South Africa will play Bridesmaid now next week at Bloemfontein, and coverage on 7 on the following day at 2 o'clock.